Why is it still so challenging to go to the moon? Progress in this world often comes through a process of trial and error. Consider Forrest Gump, who achieved, despite his limited intellect and disability. Or Harry Potter, who triumphed despite enduring significant losses. Even Rocky Balboa, with his numerous setbacks, wouldn't be the resilient character we know without overcoming challenges. It's not surprising that the same holds for science. Reflect on the Apollo missions and the numerous trials and errors they navigated to achieve the historic moon landing. Fast forward to today. Our space and tech know-how has skyrocketed. But guess what's still flippin' tricky? Yep, returning to that lunar dance floor. As we gear up for another lunar rendezvous, let's talk about the hurdles we're hurdling. Join me in the video, and I'll spill the beans on why, despite our stellar lunar legacy, revisiting the moon is like mastering advanced astrophysics. No cakewalk. We're about to dive deep into the moonwalk of history, picking up wisdom from past missions, and catching the interstellar vibes of NASA's Artemis program. A simple reason. To uncover the driving forces behind the epic journey to the moon, let's rewind to the bustling 1960s, an era dominated by the intense rivalry between the United States and the Soviet Union, known as the Space Race. Picture this. In the aftermath of World War II, both superpowers locked in a Cold War showdown, vying for supremacy in space with the ultimate goal of planting a flag on the lunar surface. We all know how that ended up. And if you don't, well, this picture is quite explicit. However, it's intriguing to note that no man would have set foot on the moon if it weren't for the Soviet Union. On October 4, 1957, they set the stage with the launch of Sputnik, the world's first artificial satellite. The celestial feat ignited concerns in the United States about national security and technological prowess. Responding swiftly, President Dwight D. Eisenhower inked the National Aeronautics and Space Act into law on July 29, 1958, birthing NASA into existence. Charged with coordinating the nation's civilian space endeavors, NASA's mission was crystal clear: explore space for peaceful purposes, advance aeronautics, and conduct groundbreaking scientific research. Fast forward, and the cosmic competition reached its pinnacle as the United States clinched victory in the moon race. But this lunar conquest wasn't just a scientific triumph, it wielded political clout. It stood as a bold declaration to the world, showcasing which nation would steer the international political narrative for the rest of the century. Now let's pause and imagine an alternate reality. One without the geopolitical tug of war. One with no Soviet Union. Would we have ventured on the lunar odyssey in 1969? The answer is elusive. The Apollo program, a mammoth effort engaging nearly 40,000 minds over 14 years, came with a hefty price tag, equivalent to a staggering $150 billion when accounting for inflation. Fast forward again, and the landscape has transformed. The political dynamics that fueled those lunar dreams have shifted. The sheer scale and cost of Apollo make a repeat scenario for sheer scientific curiosity almost unfathomable. The lingering question echoes. In today's geopolitical arena, could the U.S. summon the will and resources for a complete lunar venture? The cosmic conundrum awaits its contemporary answer. Trump and the NASA budget. In March of 2017, President Donald Trump inked a budget for NASA, dancing around the $19.5 billion mark annually, almost hitting $20 billion today. While this might sound like a cosmic cash splash, it's crucial to zoom out and realize that this financial galaxy is divided up among NASA's various divisions, and some seriously grand projects spanning our entire solar system. Wrap your mind around NASA's colossal endeavors. From the revolutionary James Webb Space Telescope to the mighty Space Launch System, and that's not even counting the epic journeys exploring the Sun, Jupiter, Mars, and the asteroid belt, the Kuiper Belt, and the farthest reaches of our cosmic neighborhood. The financial demands are out of this world, matching the vastness of the celestial terrain we're itching to explore. But let's add a bit of historical stardust for perspective. The budget, dedicated to the American space program in the 1960s, skyrocketed to a whopping 5.3% of the national budget in 1965. Then during the 1970s, the space race lost steam, and NASA faced budget cuts. The Apollo 13 mishap threw more fuel on that fire, leading to the cancellation of missions 18, 19, and 20. Since then, NASA's budget has been on a steady decline, just like your very own bank account. For four decades, it's been stuck below the 1% mark of the federal budget, and in the last 15 years, it's been cruising towards a mere 0.4%. This cosmic cash crunch, paired with shifting political priorities, has put lunar exploration in a bit of a cosmic pickle. In a nutshell, the lunar hiatus in recent decades is a mix of dwindling government interest and a tight purse. Now, as we gaze into the cosmos' crystal ball, the burning question is, can we reignite lunar dreams in a fiscal climate that keeps cutting the cosmic allowance? New technologies, new challenges. But enough now with the dollars and cents. Let's dive into the tech talk. NASA's on the brink of a lunar exploration renaissance with its shiny new toy, the Space Launch System, aka the SLS. This powerhouse rocket is ready to take the baton from the legendary Atlas V, the space steed that ferried astronauts to the moon. SLS strutted its stuff during the Artemis 1 mission, a game changer in NASA's quest to plant human feet back on the lunar soil. It is currently the most powerful rocket in the world. Its capacity to carry heavy payloads makes it a crucial component for future deep space missions. The initial configuration, known as Block 1, has a payload capacity of approximately 95 metric tons to low Earth orbit. To put this in a more humorous and unconventional perspective, if we consider the average weight of an adult male in the United States, around 88.9 kilograms according to recent data, we could playfully say that the SLS can carry roughly 1,070 Joe Bidens to low Earth orbit in a single launch. Of course, this is not a standard unit of measurement, but you got the idea. Anyway, oh boy, the road to Artemis 1 wasn't a smooth ride. The launch, not once, but twice, got the red light due to pesky issues with the rocket's fuel chambers. Even NASA, with all its space mojo, found itself grappling with technical curveballs that needed sorting before the mission could blast off. It's a cosmic truth. Space exploration is a wild ride of complexity and unexpected speed bumps. Those Apollo-era historic missions, including the triumph of Apollo 11, faced their fair share of troubles. Weather cancellations, technical glitches, Apollo had its drama. Some missions didn't even get off the launch pad, a detail often overshadowed by the program's monumental success. The same happened during the space shuttle era, when launching those sophisticated spacecraft wasn't all sunshine and rainbows. The shuttle, a marriage of rocket power and airplane aerodynamics, brought its own set of engineering puzzles. The fueling systems, different from the Apollo era, caused a bunch of cancellations. In fact, shuttle launches topped the charts in the cancellation department, with some missions delayed up to 5 times before finally lifting off. One of those launches, the Shuttle Challenger, ended up in catastrophe. The launch took place from Kennedy Space Center in Florida. The Challenger lifted off at 11:38 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, but just 73 seconds into the flight, disaster struck. The shuttle broke apart, leading to the deaths of all 7 crew members on board. The cause of the Challenger disaster was traced back to the failure of an O-ring seal in one of the shuttle's solid rocket boosters. The O-rings, which were meant to prevent hot gases from escaping, failed to function properly due to unusually cold weather on the morning of the launch. The low temperatures caused the rubberized O-rings to become brittle, allowing hot gas to escape and ultimately leading to the catastrophic structural failure of the external fuel tank. This disaster had profound impact on NASA and the space program. It resulted in the suspension of the space shuttle program. Now let's break down the SLS and the shuttle, both NASA launch machines, but they're as different as night and day. The space shuttle, partially reusable, designed for human spaceflight, a jack-of-all-trades for low-Earth orbit missions. On the flip side, the SLS is a heavyweight champion built for launching crewed and uncrewed spacecraft into deep space. Not a penny pincher, though. It's not reusable, and each part gets a one-way ticket. As we wonder why launching the SLS today feels like a cosmic conundrum, remember that the history of space exploration is a highlight reel of trial and error. Whether it's Apollo hiccups or the shuttle's hitches, each setback has been a masterclass in learning and adapting. Heading back to the moon, the past lessons propel us forward because, let's face it, navigating the cosmos is a journey filled with challenges, where bouncing back and thinking out of this world paved the way for the next cosmic leap. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve it for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. Fueling the moon landing. Before recent NASA's Artemis 1 mission could take its celestial journey, it hit a couple of roadblocks with not one but two cancellations courtesy of technical issues in the fuel system. Surprisingly, these glitches were like deja vu, reminiscent of the Apollo missions and shuttle launches, all haunted by the same specter, fuel leaks. Fuel leaks persist as the perennial nemesis in rocketry, frequently hoisting the red flag for takeoff cancellations. To illustrate, consider a recent incident involving Astrobiotics, a company that dispatched a spacecraft named Peregrine to the moon. The mission aimed for a lunar surface landing but encountered a setback due to a leak while already in space. Intriguingly, Peregrine returned to Earth, ultimately burning up in our atmosphere on January 19th. The remnants of the probe can now be located in the South Pacific. Now here's the head-scratcher. Why, with all our tech wizardry, are we still grappling with this issue today? Well, it all boils down to the star of the show, hydrogen. Hydrogen, the lightest and simplest element in our earthly arsenal, comes with its own set of challenges. Despite using processes like electrolysis to get squeaky clean hydrogen, its feather-like nature is a bit of a double-edged sword. A single gram of the stuff needs an army of billions of hydrogen atoms, and this lightweight trait allows hydrogen to pull off Houdini acts through the tiniest gaps. On our home turf, this isn't a big deal, but throw in space's icy chill and high-pressure cauldron, and things get complicated. To keep fuel tanks happy until liftoff, they're hooked up to earthly cooling systems with cables and hoses. But come liftoff, as the connections do their solo act, leaks become a headache. These connections can't be tightened like your everyday screws, making it tricky to seal the deal under the pressure and the chill of space. In a nutshell, rocket launches grapple with a tough nut to crack, the very essence of the fuel they chug. Naturally, you'd wonder, why stick with hydrogen if it's causing such problems? Thinking of alternate fuels is a no-brainer, but choosing rocket fuel is a tightrope walk of trade-offs. Hydrogen, quarks and all, brings unmatched energy efficiency and performance to the table, making it a topic despite the persistent hurdles. It's a classic case of the cosmic conundrum, dealing with the devil you know for the sake of reaching for the stars. Fuel alternatives. The logic behind NASA's steadfast use of hydrogen fuel is rooted in its stellar efficiency, delivering maximum thrust with minimal weight. Yet the narrative extends beyond mere physics. Political directives also wield substantial influence. In 2010, the US Congress dictated that NASA incorporate shuttle technology into the Space Launch System initiative, essentially inheriting the engines from the shuttle era. In the face of budget constraints, Congress urged NASA to optimize resources by leveraging existing contracts, investments, workforce, industrial infrastructure, and the launch base associated with the shuttle program for the new SLS venture. The directive carries over to the Artemis 1 project, where components like Orion 1, propulsion systems, including the infamous liquid fuel engines linked to leaks, the external storage tank, and solid fuel engines are repurposed. Essentially, Artemis 1, geared towards returning astronauts to the moon, operates on technology, rockets, engines, and a launch base reminiscent of the space shuttle era over a decade ago. The challenges of revisiting the moon are compounded by the reality that, beyond sleek touch screens, the technology propelling the Artemis 1 program isn't vastly different from what we had half a century ago. Furthermore, a compelling reason for the prolonged lunar hiatus is the pragmatic acknowledgement that there hasn't been a pressing need to return. The Apollo missions left an enduring legacy with prolific experiments and a trove of lunar samples, many of which remain unstudied by scientists to this day. Looking ahead, NASA's focus in the upcoming year shifts to objectives like Skylab, the Earth Orbiting Laboratory, and missions exploring various corners of the solar system with probes and satellites. The question arises, why return to the moon when there is still so much uncharted territory on other planets? Recent scientific strides, such as Mars exploration with robots, daily discoveries of new solar systems, and the detection of phenomena like gravitational waves, exemplify NASA's commitment to cutting-edge exploration. The moon's absence from NASA's itinerary since 1972 is not a result of conspiracy theories, but rather a complex interplay of technological heritage, budget constraints, and evolving scientific priorities. Peering into the future, NASA's Artemis project emerges as the guiding light for the next human-crewed mission to our satellite. This ambitious initiative aims not only to return, but also to make history, perhaps with a momentous step from a woman echoing the legacy of Neil Armstrong in 1969. Returning to the moon also holds significant importance in the context of future Mars exploration. It will be a crucial step in refining the necessary technologies, systems, and strategies essential for deep space missions. Our satellites provide a nearby and accessible environment where we can conduct experiments, gather data, and address challenges related to long-duration space travel, life support systems, and resource utilization. Lessons learned from lunar exploration will inform and enhance our capabilities, laying the foundation for the ambitious goal of sending humans to Mars. Yes, you got it right. The ultimate goal of the Artemis program is for us to be able to colonize Mars. The moon serves as our testbed for achieving this ambitious objective. As we wrap up our video, feel free to share your thoughts in the comments below. And stay tuned for our next adventure. We'll see you soon on the channel.